Hi, good afternoon everyone. I'm really excited to be here with you today. And I want to talk with you about exponential growth and what exponential growth actually means for organization. And to start this talk, I want to run a little experiment with you. So imagine you do 30 linear steps. How far would you come? I mean, it's pretty easy. One step is around 1 meter, you come around 30 meters. It's pretty easy. But now think, how far would you come if you do 30 exponential steps? That means the first step is 1 meter, 2 meter, 4 meter, 8 meter, and I think you got it. So just shout something. So any idea? Don't be shy. That's actually a good answer. You came 25 times around the world. It's around 10 million meters. And that actually see what's the difference between linear and exponential growth. But what does it mean for our real world? If you look back around 100 years ago, in 1903, there was a first flight from the Wright brothers. They started the first attempts to actually build an aircraft. They succeeded in 1903, and the first aircraft flew around 30 meters. Then it half crashed. And just 70 years ago, there was a Concorde flying from Paris to New York in supersonic speed. And just imagine that, in the lifetime of one human, he saw the brothers Wright building an airplane that goes 30 meters, the first airplane ever. And in the same lifetime, you see a supersonic flight from Paris to New York. And this, this exponential growth is accelerating, accelerating, and accelerating. In 2013, Google tried to gather every information humanity has created since the beginning of humanity. So how every information, every book is ever written, every picture ever drawn, and every information we as humanity created. And we created a large number of information, and it was 5 exabytes. It's 10x18 exabytes. It's an extremely large number. And it was created from the beginning of humanity to 2003. And the same time, and the same amount of information was created in 2010 in 2 days, in 2013 in 10 minutes, and soon in just about 10 seconds. Just think about all the IoT stuff is coming, every toaster gets smart, every washing machine, we're getting so many information, and then you can see what's actually happening there. And the time span to the batteries gets shorter and shorter and shorter. Around 12 years ago, Google started to work on the self-driving car. And you can see here above, it's a big camera and all the sensors in it, and it costed around $50,000 to develop the stuff that you see on top of the car. It's just the cameras and so on. And they go to the big auto manufacturers, BMW, GM, and want to partner with them. And they laugh at them. They say, nobody will pay $50,000 premium for a self-driving car. Just 3 years later, the price dropped to $8,000. Now the same technology costs $500. But it's super, super difficult to see when is the point actually coming when one technology is disrupting one. Because if you have an exponential growth, the first years are actually slower than linear growth. And you see that in the picture. And it's if you think about the digital camera, Kodak is actually, nobody knows about it, or most people don't know about it. Kodak is actually a company that invented the digital camera. The first digital camera has 0.1 megapixel in the first year. It was super shitty quality. The second year, it has 0.2 megapixel. It was still super shitty. The third year, it had 0.4 megapixel, and so on, and then 0.8. And after 5 years, they go to the board, presented their digital camera, and the board said, it's super shitty. The pictures from an analog camera are so much better, we dropped this project. And it's super hard to recognize when this point is coming. And most people think, oh, this is like the iPhone moment. And there's the Forbes from November 2007. 2007, Nokia, 1 billion customers. Can anyone ever catch the cell phone king? And you say, oh, that was the time pre-iPhone. But wrong, it was 10 months, almost a year, after Steve Jobs presented the iPhone. That's why it's so difficult to actually predict the future. And it's get faster and faster and faster. And if you think about how long does technology take to actually reach 1 million active users, the first device that actually reached 100 million active users was the telephone. It took them 75 years. The mobile took 16 years. Facebook took 4 years. Candy Crush Saga took 1.5 years. And actually, you remember, 2 years ago was Pokemon Go. Most of you played it then. Nobody plays it anymore. But it took them 1 month to actually reach 100 million users. But we still think linear, and all our organizations and big companies still think linear. So where does it come from? It comes from Tyler, where we divided employees into people that think and people that produce. But this doesn't work anymore in times of exponential growth. And here are three aspects I want to show you how organizations, how big companies we think have to change. First, planning. So you're still probably familiar with how planning works in business. You do 7-year plan or 8-year plan or 9-year plan, they agree on it, and then you execute it, and you're super, super slow. But future is not waiting, future is accelerating, and future and technology and society is so rapidly changing that you actually can't predict the future even 2 years ago. So 7-year, 8-year, 9-year plans are super obsolete. What you have to do, you have to form small groups and run very, very many experiments, tests, try what works, what not, and don't waste all the time with planning because you can't plan the future anymore anyway. But that leads to another super important point, failure culture. So if you think about how organizations run today, and if you say it's true, technology is evolving super fast and you have to run a lot of experiments, the organizations are built the opposite way. So if in an organization your project or your department dies, your career is totally fucked. So you, well, basically your career dies as well. So, and you have to rebuild the organizations the whole other way around. You want to engage people in running a lot of experiments, a lot of failures, and you really have to change organization for that. And that's super important, and not punish them for running things and try things out. And the third point, and my last point, is actually working hours. So we are still measuring success of employees in working hours. So how long does somebody physically sits somewhere, and where does this concept come from? Comes from car manufacturers 100 years ago. So if you stay at an assembly line and you work there and work on cars for 8 hours, you basically produce double the amount of cars you work there when you work 4 hours and so on. And we still keep this concept and want to apply it to knowledge workers. And if you're familiar with engineers or IT workers and so on, try to engage them, try to convince them that you're actually doing a good thing. They will build you every feature on your website, for example, on your app or whatever you want, in half a day. If they don't like what you're doing and you're not convincing them, they're building it in 2 weeks and they tell you exactly why it takes 2 weeks. So some of you dealt, obviously, with engineers. But organizations are just scratching on the surface. And what they're doing, instead of actually changing the organization and changing the way we're working right now, they're changing the offices. They're building new shiny offices and think, oh, that looks like the Silicon Valley offices from Google, from Dropbox, from so on, and then the digitization will come. But actually, disruption is starting here, in shitholes like that, where actually Jeff Bezos and Mark Zuckerberg try to actually disrupt the world. So that was my talk about exponential growth. I was actually quicker than expected. Thank you for the great audience, and thank you very much.